Good morning, Faith Community Church, and thank you so much again for joining us. We just invite you to worship Jesus right where you are with us. Know that the presence of God is in the room. Come on, let's invite His Spirit right where you are. We worship you, Jesus. Oh, we praise you. We honor your name, Lord. Come on, get excited this morning. We worship you, Jesus. Oh, I give you glory for all you've brought me through. And now I'm ready for whatever you want to do. I'm moving forward. Come on. worthy of it. We praise you. Come on, let's just continue to worship Jesus with our whole heart. We honor you, Jesus. Come on. Let's continue to exercise our faith and declare it. I see a victory. We're going to see a victory, church, in all this through Jesus. Come on. Praise you.
The weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper. When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail. Oh, my God will never fail. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. The battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. Oh, 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 oh.
that's coming, Father God, and the victory that already has been won through Jesus Christ on the cross. We trust you in this season. Oh, Lord, you've done it, and we know you'll do it again in our lives, Father God. We praise you. Come on, church. Just exercise your faith right now. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Let's put our hope and our trust in Jesus. You are worthy, Father God. You are worthy, Lord. Come on. We worship you, Jesus.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won, for you have never failed me yet.
Come on.
Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never failed me. Believe.
worship you, Lord. Come on.
Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness.
I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail. Come on, give him praise, church. We worship you, Jesus. We honor and bless your name. Lord, we thank you for this time. We thank you that we can just come before you and worship you. And Lord, in an attitude of worship, we continue on in this service. Have your way in us and through us. Give us ears to hear your word. And I pray, Father God, that as a result of hearing your word, Father God, we are changed from the inside out, that we are no longer the same. And we give you all the glory for it. We honor you. We bless you. And we give you praise. And church, if you agree, in Jesus' name, say amen. Amen.
Good morning, everybody. I want to thank you so much for joining us as we continue to live stream our service here at Faith Community Church. I'm Sarah Comis. If this is your first time worshiping with us this morning, welcome. We are so excited to have you here. We would love it if you'd comment down below so that we could welcome you personally and interact with you throughout the service. Your presence here is really important to us. If you'd like to receive more information about Faith Community Church, please visit our website at faithcc.com, or you could go to your app store and search in your app store for FaithCC space NY and download our church app. And while you're on our church app, please be sure to fill out a communication card so that we could stay connected with you. In just a few moments, Pastor Gary is going to come up to receive our offering so that everybody here at Faith Community Church has an opportunity to give. For those of you who've already given online, I want to thank you so much for your consistency and your faithfulness. And for those of you who are going to be giving during this service, I want to thank you for your generosity and your obedience to God. You could give online through our secure platform. Just go to faithcc.com/give, or you could give on our church app if you prefer that platform. Or for those of you who prefer to simply write a check, you could find our mailing address on our website, or it'll appear on our screen right now. Once again, I want to thank you so much for joining us and enjoy the service.
Good morning. God bless you. Thank you so much for joining with me once again today as we stream another service here at Faith Community Church. I'm Pastor Gary Comis. In just a moment, we're going to receive our tithe and offering as we normally do during this time. That'll give us another opportunity to support the mission here at Faith Community Church, which is transforming individuals and families through the gospel into empowered followers of Christ. I pray that as you hear the word of God today, you are empowered. Amen. You know, as we continue to manage the resources of God, we must remember that we're on a mission. And this is a mission of grace. I don't need to be ordained in order to be on this mission. You know what? I don't need any specific gifts to be on this mission. All I need is a relationship with Christ and a willingness to advance the gospel and bring life transformation to other people. And so our mission as we give is really a mission of grace. You know, and that's exactly what the Apostle Paul told the Corinthian church. He was encouraging them as he was asking them to follow the lead of the Macedonian church in their giving. And here's what he says to them in 2 Corinthians chapter 8 and verse 7. He says, "But as you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in all earnestness, and in our love for you, see that you excel in this act of grace also."
And so giving is really an act of grace. And I want us to remember that as we give today. I want to thank all of you who have already given online, those of us who are giving in this offering right now. I want to thank you guys for your generosity, your consistency, as we continue to give to support the mission here at Faith Community Church, which is transforming individuals and families through the gospel into empowered followers of Christ. This is a mission of grace. Let's pray. Let's offer our tithe and offering to Him today. Let me pray for you also that God ministers to you. He knows exactly what you're going through. He knows your needs, and God has promised to meet those needs. Let's pray. Father, we thank you. We honor you as we take our tithe and offering today. Lord, we present it to you. You are the Most High God. You are the possessor of heaven and earth. And we thank you as we give this to you with a heart of love and gratitude. Receive it, Lord. Multiply it. Continue to advance the gospel within our communities and beyond. And Father, I pray for each and everyone who is giving in this offering, who has already given. Lord, you know their needs. I pray that you would meet their needs according to your riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Thank you so much once again for joining with me as we give today and advance the gospel within our communities. God bless you, and get ready for the service. I have a good word for you, and we'll dive in just a moment.
My weakness is hidden within your glory. Jesus, my strength is in. Strength is in you. Power belongs to the one who was and is to come. Power belongs to our God. Hallelujah.
Thank you so much for joining with me once again today as we conclude this series on the stewardship of life. Get a notebook, get comfortable. We're going to learn some powerful truths today. In my first message, we learned that in order to manage God's resources successfully in life, we need God's wisdom. We need God's guidance along the way. And so I shared with you in a previous teaching a verse of scripture that's powerful. It speaks to how we ought to pray in the middle of maybe a crisis or a storm, how to seek God's wisdom. And then it shows how God will respond to us when we pray this way. Take a look with me at Psalm 32. Look at verse 7. It reads this way, "You are my hiding place from every storm of life. You even keep me from getting into trouble." I like that. "You surround me with songs of victory." You see, when we're facing the unexpected, we need to go to God. We need His wisdom. We need God's presence. We need the power of the Holy Spirit. And we go to God and we say, "Lord, You are my hiding place. You protect me from this storm that's going on right now. You even keep me out of trouble. Not only that, Lord, You surround me with songs of victory and deliverance and praise." You see, when we pray like that, we're praying in faith. We're putting our trust in Him, our confidence in Him. Here's how God responds. Take a look at verse 8. He said, "I will instruct you, says the Lord, and guide you along the best pathway for your life." Isn't that what we're praying for? God's guidance? And so we cry out to God, "Lord, I need Your wisdom. I need Your guidance." And He responds immediately and He says, "I'm going to guide you. And not only guide you on a good pathway, I'm going to put you on the best pathway for your life." He goes on to say, "I will advise you and watch your progress." Notice how God is intimate with us, especially during uncertain times of life. He is there. You are never alone. Jesus said, "I'll never leave you nor forsake you." He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And so regardless of what you're going through right now, you may be in a storm, in a crisis. This is where we pray. We put our faith and trust in God, and God promises to be there and to lead and guide us on the best pathway. When we speak of God's managing, when we speak of managing God's resources, we're really talking about everything that God has given us in life. James says it this way, chapter 1 and verse 17, you know this, every good gift, right? And every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. So all of the resources, the talents, the gifts, the things that we've acquired through our experience in life, the blessings, the favor, all of those things are good gifts from God. And we learned that we are responsible then to steward all of those things that God has placed in our lives. And we went over a couple of very important things that are in our life that we must steward. Number one, we talked about stewarding our vision. God said, "Where there is no vision, my people perish." And so you need a vision for your life, right? You need a vision for your marriage, your family, your children, your business, your career, your ministry, right? Your church, you need vision. That vision comes from God. We must learn to steward our vision. Number two, we talked about stewarding our influence. We must demonstrate character and integrity in word and in deed. There are people that are connected to us that will be impacted by our influence. People are watching you. How you respond, what you say, and especially when tough times come. And so we must learn to steward our influence. Then we talked about our commitment. This is important. Without commitment, victory in most of life's challenges are lost. And so we need to steward our commitment to stay the course, regardless of the pressures of life. Then we talked about our time. How important is this? To everything, there is a season and a time for every purpose under heaven. We've got to steward our time properly. You know, a day wasted is a day you can never get back. And so we must steward our time. And then our opportunities. God will always bring opportunities across our path. And the Apostle Paul said it this way in Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 16. He says, make the most of every opportunity. And so simply he's saying, learn to steward your opportunities. And then we steward our resources. Those are all of the things, whether monetary or material. They're all a blessing from God. They're a result of His favor. So we must steward those resources. And then, of course, we steward ourselves. We serve at the pleasure of our Master. So we must learn to steward all of these things. We also learned managing God's resources is really a reflection of our relationship with God. And that relationship is based on a pattern that we found in Proverbs chapter 3. There were five areas that we looked at in Proverbs chapter 3 as it relates to developing a responsible relationship with God. And so let me go through them once again very quickly. Number one, we talked about our heart. At the core of every act of managing God's resources is a heart that is close to God. Is your heart close to God? That's important. And then we talked about our mind. Managing God's resources is really a choice that we make to willingly support God's work and to do God's will. And then we talked about our ways. This refers to our behavior, our actions, really, which is an outward demonstration of the intents of our heart and the choosing of our mind. And so we talked about our heart, our mind, our ways. Then we talked about our purity. This speaks to really the integrity of our heart as opposed to having a divided heart. We need to be single-minded about the things of God. Purity in heart leads to power in life. And then finally, we talked about our possessions. Everything that I have belongs to Him. He made it all, He gives it all, and we need to use it all for His glory. Amen. In my second message, we talked about the stuff of life. Is it God's or is it mine? We learned how you handle the stuff of life is of great importance to God. We discovered that the stuff we are given all belongs to God. The stuff we are given is according to our ability. The stuff we are given must be utilized. The stuff we are given will hold us in account, and the stuff we are given and how we handle it reveals our view and perspective of God. And so if you've missed those two teachings, go back. The link is available for you and study along with us. Get caught up. Very important truths there. And today, once again, we're going to conclude this series with the message, Stewardship, a Mission of Grace. Let's begin with our definition that I outlined in our beginning messages about stewardship. So what is stewardship? Here is our overarching theme and definition of stewardship. Stewardship is simply the responsible planning and management of all of the resources that God has given us in life. Let me say it again. Stewardship is simply the responsible planning and management of all the resources that God has given us in life. As stewards of God's resources and followers of Christ, He gives us of the stuff of life in the form of time, talent, and treasure, and He does so according to our ability. And then He says this. We find this in Matthew chapter 9, verse 37. Jesus speaks to His disciples, and He says, the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into the harvest. Literally, from the Greek, it reads this way, to thrust out laborers into the field, into the harvest. And so We're learning that we're stewards of all of the resources that God has brought into our lives. And so as stewards, we trade, if you will, we trade with the stuff that God gives us. And the question is, what are we trading for? Well, we take our time and we're trading it for souls. We take our talent and our skills and the things we've acquired, our abilities and in life, we take all of that and we trade it for souls, advancing the kingdom of God. We take our treasure, our resources, our possessions, and we trade it for souls. You see, that's what stewards do. So as stewards, we should really have an overarching perspective on how we manage all of these things, our time, our talent, our treasure, our money, our possessions, and our things. And the Apostle Paul gives us this perspective, and he uses Jesus as the example. And so above all others, Jesus demonstrates not only that we are to give, but he demonstrates how we are to give. So let's dive in a little deeper. Let's go to 2 Corinthians chapter 8. We'll take a look at verse 9. And Paul says this, "For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, so that you by his poverty might become rich." Now, Paul makes this point very clear, that Jesus was rich in every sense of the word. It literally means he was abundantly supplied. He was rich. He was the Son of God. He possessed the nature and the fullness of God. He dwelt in glory and majesty and dominion. He received all worship and adoration. He possessed every good and perfect thing. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. He was rich. Then Paul says, though he was rich, he became poor in every sense of the word. And we find that in Philippians chapter 2, verses 6 and 9. You can read it there where it talks about Jesus through this incarnation, leaving heaven and coming into earth in order to fulfill the mission of God of redemption and reconciliation, forgiveness for humanity. And it says there that he made himself of no reputation. He was rich. He became poor. He emptied himself of his glory and his majesty. He took on the form of a servant. He was made in the likeness of men. He humbled himself. He became obedient unto death. He became poor. He was rich. He became poor. The point that Paul is making is this. Remember, Jesus is this example. Since Christ willingly sacrificed so much to help us, we ought to sacrifice to help those who are in need. Just as Jesus gave everything for us when we were in desperate need. Paul is saying to the Corinthian church, about the Macedonian church, and through them to us, that we ought to be willing to give everything to meet the needs of those who are desperately lost in the world. You see, there was an exchange that went on, that we see Jesus as an example. He was rich, he became poor. And so what do we see? The riches of Christ were given and sacrificed, becoming a mission of grace. The riches of Christ were given and sacrificed in order to be or become a mission of grace. And so, through the example of Jesus, we can see this. Here's the truth. This is the point that Paul is making here. That riches, possessions, and things, time, talent, and treasure, all have a mission outside of ourselves. We're not only blessed by those things and resources that God brings into our life and not only meets our needs, but the bigger picture here, looking at Jesus and what he did, he was rich. He became poor because he used those riches as a mission to bring redemption to other people. And so our riches, our resources, our time, talent, treasure, possession, and things must be used not only for ourselves, but they have a mission outside of ourselves. That's the message Paul is trying to convey. Now, if my resources and reserves are to have a God mission, then what informs this mission? In other words, what directs this mission? What causes it to leave me and move forward toward other people? Well, Paul shows us what it is. He describes it with one word, and that word is grace. Take a look once again, 2 Corinthians chapter 8, look at verse 9. He says, "For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ." And then he says, "He was rich, then he became poor." So in other words, this whole great exchange that we see by the example of Jesus, him giving up his riches and becoming poor, that great exchange was a result of God's grace. "For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ." So the message is this: the stewardship of life is a mission of grace. Well, what does that mean? Well, it means this: that my time, my talent, and my treasure are on a mission of goodwill and divine favor, bringing God's redemptive mercy, pleasure, and joy to those who are in need. The stewardship of life is really a mission of grace. My time, my talent, my treasure are on a mission of goodwill and divine favor, bringing God's redemptive mercy, pleasure, and joy to those who are in need. This is what we see in this particular chapter here, 2 Corinthians chapter 8 and chapter 9. Paul is teaching us several biblical facts about giving and mission. And so here's fact number one from the Apostle Paul. Giving is based on mission. Giving is based on mission. Someone said, "A life that is lived focused inward on ourselves and downward on material things is a self-defeating life. It can be compared to a black hole. The more you possess, the more you collapse under your own weight. There is another life, though, a life lived upward to the glory of God and outward for the good of people around us. A mission of grace. As believers and stewards of God's resources, we must remember that's the mission we are on. We are on a mission of grace, which is really the mission of the gospel. You know, and I don't need to be ordained to be on this mission. I don't need any special gifts to be on this mission, the mission of the gospel. All I need really is a relationship with Christ and a willingness to serve and give in order to bring life transformation to other people. That's really all I need. It begins there. Paul said it this way in 2 Corinthians 5:17. You know this. "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he's a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. All this is from God, who through Christ," look at this, "reconciled us to himself." God, through Christ, reconciled us to himself. Notice this. "And he gave us the ministry of reconciliation." Don't sit there and say you don't have a ministry. We all have a ministry. And it all begins here. It is the ministry of reconciliation, the ministry of the gospel, the ministry that we have, the responsibility, the obligation that we have to introduce people to Jesus so that Jesus can reconcile them to the Father through His sacrifice on the cross. You see, we're part of that responsibility. We're part of the ministry of reconciliation. And God, as soon as we become new creations in Christ, He immediately gives us this ministry of reconciliation. So, have you talked to somebody about Jesus lately? Have you shared the gospel with someone? Have you prayed with someone? You see, we're on a mission to advance the gospel. And we're a part of this ministry of reconciliation. And not only that, we can see in the next verse, verse 19, Paul says that he has entrusted us with the message of reconciliation. You have a ministry, you have a message. Are you sharing the truth with other people? You see, that's how we advance the gospel. We are on a mission of reconciliation, a ministry of the gospel. And notice, Paul then defines us. He calls us ambassadors. Take a look at verse 20. Therefore, we are ambassadors. In other words, I speak on behalf of Christ. I'm an ambassador for Christ. And notice this, God making His appeal through us. What a weighty responsibility that we have as believers, as ministers of the gospel. God is looking to reconcile the world, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, but it doesn't end there, it begins there. And then as we are engrafted in, as we have received forgiveness and our lives have changed, now God wants to bring that life transformation to other people. And so what does He do? He calls us as ambassadors. We have a responsibility because we're on a mission of grace. We're on a mission to share reconciliation with other people. Notice God Himself is making His appeal through us. What a responsibility. Are you faithful over that ministry? Because that's what stewardship is all about. So really, we're on a mission from God. And so our serving and our giving is all about mission. Paul chose to describe their giving, the Macedonian church, the Corinthian church, as a grace from God. Let's take a look. 2 Corinthians chapter 8, let's go back to verse 1. We want you to know, brothers, about the grace of God that has been given among the churches of Macedonia. For in a severe test of affliction, their abundance of joy and their extreme poverty have overflowed in a wealth of generosity on their part. For they gave according to their means, as I can testify, and beyond their means, of their own accord, begging us earnestly for the favor of taking part in the relief of the saints, speaking about the saints in Jerusalem. And this, not as we expected, but they gave themselves first to the Lord, and then by the will of God to us. Accordingly, we urged Titus that as he had started, so he should complete among you this act of grace. But as you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in all earnestness, and in our love for you, look at this, see that you excel in this act of grace also. I want you to notice something in verses 1, 6, and 7. Their giving was described as an act of grace. What is grace? Well, it's more than just the favor of God giving you something you don't deserve. That's certainly a part of it, but grace goes much deeper than that. We can see it in this particular story. Grace is the ability to be what God's called you to be and the ability to do what God's called you to do. And many times we come up against things in life where we no longer have the resource, we no longer have the strength, we don't have the wisdom, we don't have the ability, but yet God wants us to move forward and we cannot do it without Him. And so we lean on Him, we go to Him and we pray and He empowers us with His grace. The ability to rise above your current circumstance and be all that God's called you to be in spite of what's going on. To do what God's called you to do. And that is exactly what we see in this story. Go back to verse 2. Paul said, in a severe test of affliction, their abundance of joy and their extreme poverty have overflowed in a wealth of generosity. The Macedonian churches were going through a really bad economic time. Matter of fact, the churches in that whole region. But something came on them. They wanted to be a part of this effort in bringing assistance to other believers, the churches in Jerusalem. And they wanted to be a part of it. And so notice the grace of God hit them. There was an overflow of joy, and they made a decision in spite of their terrible circumstance. They did not allow their giving to be determined by their circumstance. Isn't that something? You see what grace does? It produces a joy that causes you to rise up and make a decision. I'm going to be a part of this thing because I know it's the right thing to do. And I'm not going to allow my current circumstance to dictate to me how I should behave. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to allow the grace of God to empower me. It gave them the joy they needed. And notice what happened. It moved them in a position that they responded with a willing heart, and it took them beyond their ability. And Paul said that they gave according to their ability and beyond their ability. They stepped outside of themselves. What does grace do? It gives you the strength. It gives you the determination to put your faith and trust in God and be obedient to God. And apparently, Paul knew that they were stepping out in faith, so much so that there must have been, I guess, some concern on the Apostle Paul, because he knew how dire their circumstance was. And notice what Paul says. They gave beyond their means, according to their means, and then beyond their means. And then the Macedonian church, they were begging the Apostle Paul to be a part of this relief effort for the other churches in Jerusalem. They were begging. In other words, Paul, look, we're doing this. Don't leave us out. We want to sow our seed in the things of God right now. And Paul received it. You see, the Macedonian church, they used this occasion to rededicate their lives and possessions to the Lord. And I think we all have an opportunity, even now. Our world has been turned upside down over the last 6 months or so. And, we've been thrust into circumstance beyond our control. But it's not beyond God's control. And I think we can use this time and not be fearful, not be afraid, but to learn to really dig deeper in our relationship with God and put our faith and trust in Him. Learn to respond based on relationship, not based on fear, right? Learn to respond based on what the Holy Spirit leads you to do instead of what the circumstances are telling you about what you should do. So we have an opportunity, like the Macedonian church, to rededicate ourselves now and go to God and say, Lord, regardless of what's happening and the the conditions of my life financially, emotionally, maybe physically, the uncertainty that we're all experiencing. Lord, in the midst of all of this, I want you to know I serve at the pleasure of my master. I rededicate my life to you. Come on, tell them that right now. I rededicate my life to you right now. All that I am, Lord, all that I hope to be, all of my possessions, my time, my talent, and my treasure, it all came from you, and I give it back to you. That's what the Macedonian church did. They dedicated themselves first to the Lord. You see, that's how come they were able to respond with their resources, because they gave themselves first to God. They dedicated their possessions to the cause of God, and they dedicated themselves to minister with the Apostle Paul. So what do we see? A mission of grace. Paul's using the giving example of the Macedonian church to encourage and remind the Corinthian church of their commitment to give over a year ago. That's why this was written. So let's now move into that part of this story. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 8. Look at verse 10 now. Paul writes, "Last year you were the first not only to give, but also to have a desire to do so." Look at this. "Now finish the work, so that your eager willingness to do it may be matched by your completion of it according to your means." Now, apparently, as I mentioned previously, the churches in this region were probably all going through difficult economic times. In verse 1, we read in chapter 8, we saw that there was a great trial of affliction and their deep poverty. And so it must have affected that whole region. It must have affected the Corinthian church as well, because Paul reminds them of their promise. They started to give a year ago, but they were not following through. Something happened. Sometimes, listen now, a mission of grace is interrupted by the unexpected. Sometimes a mission of grace can be interrupted by the unexpected. An economic crisis, a political upheaval, a health concern, family concerns, a number of other concerns. You see, it happens. Life sometimes turns on a dime. And so our plans get interrupted. Our movement gets interrupted. Our commitment could get interrupted. That's what was going on here. And so Paul reminds the Corinthian church that they are still on a mission of grace and encourages them to finish the work. "Now is the time," he says, "to forge ahead." You see, my giving is not determined by my circumstance. My giving is determined by my relationship with Christ and my mission. And so Paul's first point here is giving is based on mission. Number two, giving is based on a decision, not a feeling. Somebody said too many people are spending money they haven't earned to buy things they don't need to impress people they don't like. Billy Graham once said, if a person gets his attitude toward money straight, it will help straighten out almost every other area in life. You see, everyone desires to give on some level. But like the Corinthian church, sometimes our desire fades because of some intervening circumstance. Paul acknowledges their desire. See, He understands life happens. God understands life happens, right? Paul acknowledges their desire, and then he now speaks to their willingness and their readiness. Take a look at verse 11, 2 Corinthians 8. He says, "Now finish the work, so that your eager willingness to do it may be matched by your completion of it, according to your means. For if the willingness is there," he goes on to say, "the gift is acceptable according to what one has, not according to what he does not have." You see, God is looking for a willing heart, a ready heart to respond to him. And when life interrupts us and we get maybe knocked off center, the Spirit of God will always encourage us, like he's doing through the Apostle Paul with his word, to get us back on center. And there will be the voice of God that says to you, "Now finish the work." You see, the mission of grace continues. People still need to hear the gospel, regardless of what's going on. Matter of fact, especially because of what's going on. The word of God has got to get out in a greater degree. This is not a time to pull back. This is now a time to dig deeper in our resolve where the things of God are concerned, because the mission must continue. Say amen to this. And the reason why that is, here's the mindset. Because the proclamation and the distribution of the gospel cannot be supported by good intentions alone. Everybody has good intentions. They always want to do more, but they can't. You know, if I was in this position, if I was making more money, if I had these resources, everybody has good intentions, and that's wonderful. But the gospel cannot be distributed by good intentions alone. You see, that's why Jesus said this. Once again, we go back to Matthew chapter 9, verse 37. He said, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray," notice this, "pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest that he thrusts out, he sends out laborers into the field." You see, we've got to get this job done. The mission continues. That's why Paul said in Romans chapter 10, verses 14 and 15, he said it this way. He says, "How then will they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in him and of whom they have never heard? And how are they going to hear without someone preaching? And how are they to preach unless they are sent?" You see the process? The end result is for the gospel to bring life transformation to someone who needs a relationship with God. And so Paul says that's where we need to be. That's the mission. How is that going to happen? Notice we can back it up. How is that going to happen unless the preacher gets sent? And the preacher preaches the word. How is that going to happen? How are they going to believe unless they hear? And how are they going to hear unless the gospel is proclaimed? You see, it's the mission that never ends. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 7 and 8, Paul says it this way. He said, "Each one must give, as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver." Don't give to God when you're mad about giving. God doesn't appreciate that. God wants us to understand that we all have a responsibility, and God knows you have need of these things. He knows what's going on in our lives. Matter of fact, Jesus taught about that in Matthew chapter 6. And he says, don't be like the Gentiles who strive after all of these things. God knows you have need of these things, what you need to eat and wear and your shelter, your home. And he says he knows you have need of these things. So what do? Jesus said, but seek first the kingdom of God, God's way of doing things. And then all of these things that God knows you need will be added to you. So don't bring your gift to God and be offended by doing so, or being mad at God that you're feeling like you're forced to do. God doesn't want that. He's looking for all of us to understand that we are on a mission. And so he says to the Corinthian church and then to us, each one must give. And when you give, be cheerful about it. Why? Because like the Macedonian church, all of a sudden they got hit with joy. They weren't moved by their circumstance. They just went beyond that. And the grace of God lifted them. And they said to Paul, man, we're going to be a part of this thing. So God loves a cheerful giver. And notice what God will do when we respond that way. Look at verse 8. God is able to make all grace, there it is again, abound to you. Notice what this grace now is going to do. Look at this. So that having all sufficiency in all things at all times, you may abound to every good work. Isn't that what we want? Of course it is. Don't you want all sufficiency in all things at all times and be in a position to abound to every good work? You see, that's what the grace of God does. That's what happens when we respond as stewards of God's resources, knowing that we are on a mission of grace. Our time, talent, treasure, money, possession, and things are on a mission of grace. So, the mission of grace continues regardless of the state of the economy, regardless of how many laborers we have in the field, right? Regardless of the prevailing circumstance, the mission continues. And so, Paul's second point is our giving must be tied to our mission. Finally, his third point is this: giving is based on faith and commitment. In the book, The Treasure Principle, Randy Alcorn says this: in fact, 15% of everything Christ said relates to this topic of money and possessions more than his teachings on heaven and hell combined. Why did Jesus put such an emphasis on money and possessions? Because there's a fundamental connection between our spiritual lives and how we think about and handle money. We may try to divorce our faith and our finances, but God sees them as inseparable. Isn't that something? How can you remain on this mission to give and support the ministry of the gospel when life seems to be intent on stopping you from doing it? You see, Paul doesn't beat up the Corinthian church, but he challenges them to rise up in faith. And many times that's exactly what we must do. He urges them, 2 Corinthians chapter 8, look at verse 11 once again, now finish the work. He's calling them to rise up, move beyond the circumstance. If you read into chapter 9, Paul reminds them that really this is a matter of faith whereby we begin to trust God. We're not moved by circumstance. We want to be a part of what God is doing. And so we rise above and we do so in faith. We put our faith and trust in God, that God will provide. And that's what Paul says to them. Take a look at this very important verse. Look at this. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 10. He, speaking of God, who supplies seed to the sower, and bread for food will supply and multiply your seed for sowing and increase the harvest of your righteousness. So notice this, Paul really speaks to several different important things. Number one, he's saying God is the one who is the source of your supply. So when you sit down and you write a check and you sow into a church, a ministry, when you, when you go online and you, you contribute, however you do it, Paul is immediately reminding us that that seed that you sowed came from God. He provided that. He gave you that seed. Notice what he says. He who supplies the seed for the sower. So that seed comes from God. That means that God is your source of supply. It's not your job, it's not your resources, it's not your networking or anything else. God is your source of supply. He provides seed to the sower. He provides bread for the eater. Another translation says, bread for your food. He's supplying your seed so you can sow. He's supplying your now material resources so you can be sustained. And notice, he doesn't stop there. It says that he will then multiply your seed for sowing and increase the harvest of your righteousness. And so, what is the process here? God provides seed for sowing. And so, there may be somebody out there that will look into their life right now and say, I have absolutely nothing to sow. I have no seed to sow. Well, I would challenge that, but that's not my point right now. My point is this. If you feel you have no seed to sow, you have nothing, you go to God and God's promised to provide you with seed. Why does he want to do that? Because he wants you to ultimately have a harvest. You can't have a harvest unless you have a seed. You can't have a seed unless God provides it. He provides the seed for sowing and will then multiply that seed so that you have a harvest. You see how the process works? And so this giving that is a mission of grace is really based on faith and commitment, so that we could abound to every good work. So now notice what God then says. Look at verse 6, 2 Corinthians 9. Paul says this. Well, the point is this. Whoever sows sparingly will reap sparingly. I think, right? Everybody knows that. Every farmer knows that. I think we all know that too. If you only put little seed in the ground, you're only going to get a little harvest. I mean, that's just common sense. And Paul is talking now in very practical terms, although these two entire chapters are talking about giving with your resources for the sake of advancing the mission of the gospel. And so, he's now getting very practical. He's speaking on a level where everybody can understand. And so he says this. The point is this. Whoever sows sparingly will reap sparingly. Whoever sows bountifully will reap bountifully. I mean, that's obvious, right? That's common sense. Now notice this. Each one must give. We've got to give something. You see, because we are stewards of God's varied grace. We have to give something. Each one must give. As he has decided in his heart, right? Not reluctantly or under compulsion, right? God doesn't want you to be mad at this process. Each one must give. Notice God loves a cheerful giver. And notice the promise now. When we do this, we respond in faith and in commitment to God. God is able to make all grace abound to you so that having all sufficiency in all things at all times, you may abound to every good work. I love this verse, Proverbs 11:24. In the Message version, it reads this way. The world of the generous gets larger and larger. The world of the stingy gets smaller and smaller. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 17 to 19, Paul says this. He drives the point home here. He says, as for the rich in this present age, charge them. Timothy, speak into their lives. Charge them not to be proud, not to be haughty, nor to set their hopes on uncertain riches. I think we are all aware now, more than ever, that, you know, you can have resources one day and it could be gone the next. And so Paul is again reassuring them that God is their source, right? He says, charge them that are rich in this world that they're not haughty, nor to set their hopes on uncertain riches, but on God who richly provides us with everything to enjoy. You see the heart of God here? The nature of God? He wants to meet your needs. He wants you to enjoy life. He's providing things for you to enjoy. But then we have a responsibility with these resources, right? And here's what Paul says in verse 18, that they are to do good. Notice, to be rich in good works, to be generous, and ready to share. Well, what will happen as a result of that? See, Paul is, again, he's saying pretty much the same thing he said in Corinthians, 2 Corinthians chapter 9, he who sows sparingly will reap sparingly. He tells us back then that God is our source. He'll supply seed for the sower, right? Well, what will happen if we respond that way? Well, he who sows sparingly will reap that way. He who sows bountifully will reap that way. Notice he's saying the same thing. They're to do good. They're to be rich in good works, be generous and ready to share. Look at this. Thus storing up treasure for themselves as a good foundation for the future. He's talking about your harvest. So that they may take hold of that which is truly life. You see how this all works together. And so giving is always a matter of faith and commitment. So in the stewardship of life, we are on a mission of grace. What do we learn? Based on the example of Jesus, we can see that now our riches, possessions, things, time, talent, and treasure all have a mission outside of ourselves. To preach and teach the gospel, to help meet the needs of humanity so as to bring salvation and life transformation to many other people. We're on a mission of grace. And so these three points that Paul makes, number one, giving is based on mission. We're on a mission of grace. We must respond. The mission continues regardless of what is going on around us. Number two, giving is based on decision. The mission continues. And so we're not going to allow the current circumstance to challenge us and knock us off center. And number three, giving is based on faith and commitment. We must continue to trust God through all of the seasons of our life, because He will provide what He has promised. We are on a mission of grace, and that is why the stewardship of life is so important to God. He brings all of these resources to us. He expects us to steward properly our time, our talent, our treasure, our money, our possessions, and our things in order not only for our needs to be met, but in order to advance the gospel so that lives can be changed by the power of God. Amen? I pray you got something out of this message today and, of course, out of this series. I want to pray before we close down today. I want to pray that we all rise to the occasion. We can all be challenged when, especially when life turns and we feel, you know, a crisis or maybe a struggle come on, and we need to put our faith and our trust in God. I want to pray that we're focused on what Paul is speaking to us, that we're on a mission. This mission continues. And so we're going to do our part, and we can't do it without God's grace. So we're going to lean on Him. Amen. We're going to pray. We're going to trust Him as we continue to sow our seed and advance the gospel. Amen. Let's go to God together. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank You, Lord, for who You are. Thank You, Lord, that You are the Most High God, the possessor of heaven and earth. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. And Father, we thank You for all of the resources that You have placed within our lives. And we make a commitment today. We rededicate our lives to You. Father, we serve at the pleasure of our Master. And we're asking You to use us, Lord, in ways that perhaps You've never done before. Father, we rededicate all of our possessions to You, our time, our talent, our treasure, our resources. Lord, we dedicate those things to You. And Father, we want to be used as a minister of reconciliation. Lord, help create opportunities where we can continue to share the gospel and speak the truth and the message of reconciliation so that lives can be changed by the power of God. I pray that your life is changed by the power of God. If you've never given your heart to Christ, I pray that you do that right now. You recognize that you need a Savior. Jesus paid the price for your sins. That was His mission. And we just need to understand that, repent of our sins, ask forgiveness, and then receive Christ as our Savior and our Lord and follow Him. I pray that you would do that. Make that decision today. Give your heart to Christ. He'll never let you down. I pray for those of us who maybe are struggling financially. We're going through a hard time economically. And I pray, Father, that you would touch them, that you would meet their needs, that you would make a way, Lord, where there seems to be no way. I stand in agreement with them, Father. Lord, that You not only supply the seed for sowing, Lord, but You multiply that seed. I pray, Father, that You would multiply their harvest, that all of their needs are met according to Your riches in glory by Christ Jesus. In Jesus' name, and everybody said, amen and amen. Thank you so much for joining with me once again. Thank you for being part of this series. If you missed the other teachings, go to the link. Access those teachings, study along with us so that you can continue to grow in this very important topic. Remember, the mission always continues. Be a part of His mission, and God will use you in tremendous ways. Thank you for joining with us. We'll be back here once again next week, 10 a.m., 7:30. We have midweek service. My wife is teaching a great series. And join with us then. We also have life groups available, different opportunities. So plug in along the way. Stay connected here at Faith Community Church. And I want to thank you for your continued support of the mission of Faith Community Church, which is transforming individuals and families through the gospel into empowered followers of Christ. I pray your life has been empowered today. Amen. God bless you. Don't forget to share the program. All right. Do that right now before we close, and get this word out to your family and your friends. Amen. God bless you. This is Pastor Gary reminding you, stay safe and stay in faith.
So faithful, so constant, so loving and so true. So powerful in all You do, You fill me, You see me, You know my every move, and You love for me. To so patient, so gracious, so merciful and true, so wonderful in all you do.
Dedicated to you. We pray that you are honored by it. And Lord, I thank you for each and every person joining with us. I pray over them, Father God. Bless them as they go, Father. I pray that your Holy Spirit, Father God, will lead them and guide them. I pray that each and every one of us will be drawn to our knees every day seeking you, Lord, and allowing your Spirit to lead and guide our every step. We honor you. We bless you. And church, if you agree, in Jesus' name, say amen. Amen. Give him praise. Amen. Thank you guys so much for joining us. We just encourage you, come back next week and worship with us again. Have a great week.